doses and mimosas. You probably heard that same joint at some frat party, but don't immediately write off Cherub's work. They've been in the industry since 2011, and they just released their EP, Gummo Season. On Talk Breaks, Alex Walls interviews Cherub at State Theater to discuss their influences in music, feature culture, and their advice towards a younger generation of artists of today.
We're Cherub. You're listening to the radio.
WZMB.
Ow! Actually, it's the radio on the internet.
91.3.
You're disturbing the peace.
Disturbing the mainstream.
And we're here to help you guys disturb the mainstream. Is that too much?
Oh, that's fine. That's perfect. All right.
What's up? I'm Alex Falls with WZMB 91.3. We're here today with the one and only Cherub. How y'all doing today?
Good. How are you, man?
Doing all right. So, Jordan, you've said in the past you're quite the metalhead.
Yeah.
Do you ever think that we're going to hear any more, like, metal influences in future music coming out?
I don't know. I actually just talked to one of my buddies that I grew up with, and he drums, and he was like, dude, we should, like, jam on some metal riffs sometimes, you know, like, really sludgy metal, you know, it'd be great. But, I guess I'd say of all my influences that I would say, like, the metal music I listen to is the most hidden in the Cherub stuff, you know? Like, I don't really feel like you'd listen to it and be like, oh, he probably listens to, like, blast beat shit, you know?
Yeah, it only really comes out on the live show.
When we just start screaming and shit.
We do
a lot more guitar solos and throw some distorted stuff in there. It's definitely noisier live, but it would be tight to do some metal stuff for sure.
A little bit of screaming or something.
Dude, I would be totally down to scream. But if I started a metal project, I wouldn't want to be the front man. I'd want to be the guitarist. I would want somebody else to do the scream. Yeah.
You get Sam, dude.
Yeah. Sam can do it. He's good at screaming.
So y'all met each other at Middle Tennessee State.
Yeah.
Do the local music scene there or the Nashville music scene impact y'all's music in any way?
I mean, both of the above. We were actually just talking about on stage the house shows at Trash Mountain we used to play and shit like that in Murfreesboro. That's where we started, like, cutting our teeth and whatnot. But up in Nashville, we've played with so many other friends from Nashville and then just the area in general. I guess that we met them in Nashville and they've since moved out of the area. But it's always been cool to be a part of it, but an outlier in that country music scene. Everybody always thinks of country when they think of Nashville.
Right.
So it's been cool to tour from Nashville and, you know, show people that we're not just country music there.
Awesome. So what are your thoughts on feature culture and, like, the idea of needing a feature to make a pop hit?
I think it's f***ing stupid.
Yeah, I mean, I'd have to agree with that. I don't think you need a feature to make a pop hit.
I actually have never even heard of that until you brought it up, but I think that, you know, and I'm all about the old school, like, the throwback when you'd have, like, any No Limit release or something where, like, there'd be 10 different rappers on an album, you know, that was great, you know. I don't know why that makes more sense to me, but I think when you break down a pop song and there's 8 writers involved, I guess if that works for the process of those people, it seems like a clusterfuck to me. So maybe I just don't understand it. So maybe not fuck that. Maybe I retract that statement. If it works for you, cool, but for me it seems crazy.
No, like y'all style. Like,
yeah, I mean, we've always done everything in-house. The writing is we've collaborated with some people. We've collaborated with Gibbs and a few of our other friends, but for the most part, it's just been, you know, between us and one other dude that helps mix and master stuff. So
y'all's music has a very unique sound, but it definitely has, like, a 1980s synth feel on a lot of the tracks. Are there any particular artists from the 80s that inspires your music or, like, you look up to?
Yeah.
I mean, immediately, Prince is a big one.
I was actually about to ask about Prince, because I hear it in the vocals.
But all sorts of stuff. Mm-hmm. We grew up listening to a lot of music. Our parents shared music with us. We grew up on the radio and stuff, too, so.
Tears for Fears, Zap.
Yeah.
All those artists, like, all those soft synths that came out and, like, sound super lush, and those were really, really heavy influencers on,
like, the new wave and alternative
stuff. Great, you know, and they also were throwing a lot of chorus on their guitars and just, like, I don't know, it was a crazy time because synthesizers were fairly still brand new to a certain extent, so people were just doing weird shit with them. Mm-hmm. Still trying to figure out that whole element of music that was new. So, yeah, for sure.
If I could change anything about the industry, what would it be?
I don't know. I think we've had it pretty easy for, like, compared to, like, stories we've heard. I mean, we signed with a major label a couple years in. We didn't have to, like, wait a decade to get put on. And the A&R that signed us was a really honest and good dude and, like, never took advantage of us. And, you know, at the end it didn't end up working out, mostly for the label money-wise, you know, like, truthfully. But they let us go without any strings attached and let us continue to make music independently. And we've always had great management and a team. And so I really have no gripes with the music industry at all. Mm-hmm. I am pretty grateful for the ride so far.
How do you think music and pop culture will shift in the upcoming decade?
I think that pop music has gotten a negative connotation towards it in the sense that people think of pop music, they think of like a hollow, kind of just like emotionless song that's just factory produced and there's nothing behind it, you know what I mean? And I think that pop music to me is just a really well-crafted song that's catchy. And it can be like a really powerful song, you know? And there still is pop music being made like that. And I just hope that it can, you know... I think it is already happening where there's this like... Like, look at Tame Impala or some, an artist like that. They were super lo-fi, kind of like, I don't want to say underground, but you wouldn't really consider them mainstream. They're very eccentric sounding for what mainstream would be. But they become very mainstream. And all these artists, you know, like Rihanna and all these mainstream artists want to take that sound and make it pop or whatever, you know. But it is pop, you know. It's just super catchy and really well-written tracks.
Do you think stuff like streaming services has helped, like, groups like Tame Impala kind of get that pop mainstream appeal?
Yeah, I think...
Let him in!
What's up, dog? Oh, my
God damn it, Gibbs!
Wait, we gotta... Don't say bad words. What? Hug f***!
What venue would you say is the most fun to perform at that y'all have done?
The, like, a venue?
Yeah, or like...
We played, like, some really epic venues, man.
Most fun is hard to say, because it's all based on the crowd.
Tonight could be the most fun.
Yeah.
And, like, who knows how many people show up, but really it's so random, the energy with the crowds. I mean, we've played huge shows and, like... I felt no connection with the crowd, and I've played huge shows and was like, wow, everybody was dialed in, and I've played, you know, it's just, it varies so much. I mean, we definitely have, like, a bucket list of venues that were super epic for us to play, so just that alone was just kind of like, yeah, you know?
All depends on the energy they're bringing.
Yeah. I mean, even if they didn't bring energy, you'd be like, well, fuck it, I'm still, like, you know, the Ryman or Red Rocks or the Gorge or, you know, some of the, you know. Yeah, maybe I'll think of it as this goes.
What would you say is the toughest obstacle y'all had to overcome?
In specifically...
Music industry.
Music, yeah. Like, in life?
Oh, not that deep. Just like, with music we're talking about.
I think the toughest obstacle is making a sound that you're proud of, that you can put out and not care what other people are going to think of it, and then fully... embrace that and push it and get other people to hop on and believe in it.
Yeah.
That's the hardest part. And then after that, once the ball starts rolling, then people catch on to the vibe and you can start gaining confidence and all that. But that beginning push is just confusing, man. And I spent like a year, which doesn't seem like a lot of time, but it was a daily struggle mentally for me to figure out how I can make music that I can feel comfortable singing on, because I wasn't even comfortable singing at the time. So you just gotta do it, and then find a Nick Curtis that can mix and master it, and then you're all good.
Except for Nick.
Yeah.
Just find that one sound that works. Yeah.
Yeah. And just go for it, man. Go for broke. We always say go for broke. It's like, I don't know if it's the best advice, but it definitely pushes you.
Of course. So, Cherub got their start more kind of the old-fashioned way, through, like, constant touring.
Yeah.
Would y'all recommend this method to the younger generation of musicians trying to get started?
100%.
Oh, yeah.
The internet is not real. I mean, though it is, and a lot of things are based upon that. Like, if you spend your time in the internet world, you won't You won't make those connections with people, and that's what keeps the whole thing going, you know? You started playing shows to five people, they told their friends, more people came out, they told their friends, more people came out, and that's how we've had people that have been rocking with us for years now, you know? Some people will not focus on that and then expect things to just happen and they get frustrated when they don't. And you learn a lot of lessons the hard way doing it the long way.
I also think that we came up, like, the first year or two of touring for us, it was like almost pre-Instagram.
Oh, it was.
And Twitter and stuff. So now that that's a thing, that wasn't a thing when we first started. So now that that's a thing, I mean, if you're an artist and you know, there's some artists that are just social media personalities, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And they don't rely on their show so much, but they can still make income from that. And for us, since we started doing it grassroots style, that's what makes sense to us. But if you're also like wanna do the other route where you're just popping off on social media and doing that, like, to me, as kind of like an older dude or, you know, someone that might not fully understand it, I'm you that would be like, that's whack. But then if you think about it, you're like, well, if it works for them, you know? Mm. So I don't know. I guess I'm a bit torn. I think if you want to do grassroots, cool. If you want to.
That's actually all the questions I have. Thank y'all so much for coming, Cherub, and letting us speak.
We'll fix it in post. Those are really good questions, man.
Thank you.
Yeah, those are sweet. Thank you.
Those are not run-of-the-mill questions. I really appreciate
it. This is actually
that.
My first interview with y'all, so.
That's, I mean, yeah, hell yeah.
Nice meeting y'all.
Yeah, dude. Nice meeting you too.